Scholastic Audio presents Show Me a Sign by Ann Clare LeZotte, read by Nora Hunter. Dedicated to the memory of my brother, Peter George LeZotte, 1968 to 2016, and to the fellow dreamers and adventurers of our youth. A message to audiobook listeners from Ann Clare LeZotte, the author of Show Me a Sign. To my listeners, the year is 1805 on Martha's Vineyard. 11-year-old Mary Lambert lives in a community where her deafness is not unusual, and everyone speaks a unique form of sign language. While Mary is mourning the death of her brother, a scientist comes to the island and turns her life upside down. While working as a public librarian, I noticed how few books were written by deaf authors about our history, language, and culture. I wanted to write a compelling story where deaf kids could see themselves and where hearing kids could see the world from a perspective they may never have thought of before and understand that we're no different from them, except for the ability to hear. While I cannot enjoy audiobooks, I'm grateful this format exists for readers with visual impairments, intellectual disabilities, learning disabilities, and physical disabilities that impede motor skills, as well as for audiobook fans. I hope you enjoy listening to Mary's story. Ann Clare LeZotte, author of Show Me a Sign. The deaf are everywhere. They existed before you spoke of them and before you saw them. Laurent Clare, deaf Frenchman and the first deaf teacher in America. Prologue. If you are reading this, I suppose you want to know more about the terrible events of last year, which I almost didn't survive, and the community where I live. Every small village must think itself perfectly unique. I now know there was not another like ours in America in the year of our Lord, 1805. For those who take hearing and speaking for granted, our way of life may be hard to understand. You may be fooled into believing that Chilmark, on Martha's Vineyard, an island south of Boston, is a fancy of my imagination, or the lost paradise that the English captain who named the land after his daughter was seeking long ago. I've tried to be true to every detail and do justice not only to my friends and family, but also to my enemies. It was the stranger invited to our shores who changed my view forever. I warn you, there are accounts of great wickedness, along with hope, in these pages. As for my mastery of the language, I will remind you that not every writer comes to English from the same direction. My story is built not with brick and mortar, but by finding the right words and making events come to life. If it were a palace, it would have many windows and doors to see your reflection, peer into, and walk through. I hope you will be brave enough to enter. Mary Elizabeth Lambert. Part 1. Chapter 1. I like to walk early in the morning, before I begin my chores, even in this crisp November weather. I use my birch stick to poke at curious things on the ground, like the tunnels made by moles. They go so deep, they churn up the sand below the soil. When I leave home early enough, I can see bright flashes from the gay headlight in the distance. But today, the sun is up. I run my stick across the top of the mossy stone wall that frames the high road and watch the sea glitter behind gabled houses with sloping yards. Seagrass borders the sand, blowing lightly in the cool breeze. Blue crabs burrow into the mud near the shore, where they'll lay dormant for the winter. On the beach, there's little left of the humpback whale that washed upon our shores 4 days ago, delivered by the Almighty. My closest friend, Nancy Skiff, and I discovered the whale while playing. It was already dead when we found it, but its smell was not yet putrid. Small seabirds pecked at its carcass. Its sea-worn, mottled black skin was covered in humps and bumps. We were awestruck by its massive bulk. Nancy and I walked a large circle around it. I collected scallop shells, moon shells, and quahog shells and put them next to the whale as a final offering from a human friend. Nancy took a recorder out of her cloak and played a song to guide the beast to its end. When Nancy and I ran to get her father, my papa, and the other men, they came with spades, knives, rope, and wheelbarrows. As they made plans to dispose of the whale, Papa, sensing my sadness, signed to me assuredly, "Not one piece shall go unused. Meat for the whole town, oil for our lamps, and baleen in the beast's mouth for brushes." I couldn't watch as our treasure was flensed, cut, and taken away piece by piece. I stop and write whale in the sand with my stick. I love words, but they confound me too. The way my mind thinks is not just in signs or English words and sentences, but in images and a flow of feeling that I imagine resembles the music I've never heard. I watch the tide leaping in and out. I pass a stretch of high road that I have come to avoid. I circle around it as if it is hallowed ground and head back home. Leaves jump and twirl ahead of me. The wind beckons me toward a small graveyard. I choose to ignore its silent whispers. Chapter 2. Great warmth and a savory smell emanate from our kitchen. A large, clean brick fireplace dominates the room, along with the kettle hanging from a trammel hook. I step through a beautiful slice of sunlight on the floor and touch my mother's back. "Morning," she signs, one hand rounded like the sun, the other arm acting as the horizon it climbs. "Morning. Cooking?" I ask, mimicking stirring a pot. Mama signs, "For supper." She points to the meat pie on the table. I helped her make it 2 days ago. Today is the last serving. She places the pitcher beside me on the table. I'm to fill it from a shallow well in our yard. "First, pie eat." Mama delicately wipes the back of her hand across her sweat-beaded forehead. Even with the dirt smudges, her face is beautiful, with cheeks reddened by the fire. Her black hair and blue eyes are like coal and sky. George had her coloring. Mama glances at his empty chair and blinks away unshed tears. Then she's back to work, with her spoon dipped in the large kettle. I dutifully finish the last piece of meat pie and grab the pitcher. Mama taps me on the shoulder. I turn around to face her. "3, she signs, holding up as many fingers. I am to fill the pitcher 3 times, adding the water to the kettle 2 times. Always, the last pitcher is for cleaning up. The task is easy enough. Papa dug a shallow well right next to our house, by the pear and apple trees. On an island, you can't dig a well too deeply, unless you want to drink and cook with salt water. Back in the kitchen, I rinse corn, beans, and squash from our garden. These foods grow plentifully in every season. The Wampanoag, the local Indians, call them the Three Sisters. They work together to grow. Corn provides height for the beanstalk. Squash provides mulch. And the beans provide beneficial gases to the soil. There is much discord between the Wampanoag and us vineyarders that I know worries Mama and Papa. Papa says that we both lay claim to the same tracts of land, and the Commonwealth of Massachusetts goes back and forth in its rulings. The Wampanoag believe land should be held collectively, rather than as personal property. How can that be? Papa is sympathetic to the Wampanoag. Perhaps it's because he labors side by side with them on the farm. Mama socializes only with English women. She is glad early missionaries to the island succeeded in Christianizing so many Wampanoag. I was raised to accept her beliefs. But ever since George died too young and without just cause, I have begun to question everything. When I'm done cooking, I'm supposed to wipe the table. But instead, I watch Mama wash a dish and wonder at her contentment with her daily chores. She always does them meticulously and with great calm. The last time I stacked the plates, I chipped two of them. I prefer making up stories. I saw a lion on the beach today, I sign. Mama wrinkles her brow as she carefully lays a pan of hot cranberry muffins on a trivet. She shakes her head and signs, You shouldn't tell tall tales. But it's true, I insist, tapping my index finger against my closed lips. Tell me, Mama signs. She takes off her apron and sits down at the wooden table Papa built. I sweep my hair away from my eyes. It is important that my face shows, even though it is positively dull. I don't have Mama's and George's fine features. My thick hair, which Mama calls the color of sunlight, has cowlicks that don't curl as smartly as other girls' hair. It gives me lumpy braids. And I'm too young for a bun. I tuck it behind my ears, and it hangs to the middle of my chest. I remain standing so I can express myself with my whole body, not just my hands. When the tide came roaring in today, I saw the lion. Mama frowns. There are no lions on Martha's Vineyard, she signs emphatically. Ezra Brewer put those ideas in your head. No, it was Miss Hammond. I love her teachings. She always shares fascinating stories from her brother-in-law, who is a sailor. He claims he saw a mermaid once. And Miss Hammond says the lion is the king of the jungle. We have no jungles, Mary. No lions. Mama's eyes are watery. And her shoulders slump. The dark waves were so high, and the sea spray was white against them. I sign, my eyes and mouth wide open to show awe. I stayed back. One wave got bigger and bigger, and it looked like a lion's head roaring before it crashed against the rocks. That is fanciful, Mama signs. It's not true life. But it looked like a lion to me, I sign. I see Mama sigh. She has never had time for fancies. Papa enjoys when I tell a tale, and George was always most excited by my whimsies. His amusement at my storytelling made me perform more energetically. I sometimes even teased a smile out of Mama. Mama stands up and begins to remove the muffins from the pan. I help her, then wrap two in a cloth. Walk beach. Give to Ezra Brewer. I sign. Mama nods, but I can read a slight look of disapproval in her face. Ezra Brewer is not Mama's favorite inhabitant of our township, Chilmark. I'm not sure why she dislikes him. Papa enjoys his company and stories. I sometimes wonder if his farmer's heart longs for the excitement of the high seas. I promise I'll return later to help you, I sign, crossing my fingers behind my back. As I walk out the door, I think I see Mama call out to me from the corner of my eye. George was hearing like Mama. I am deaf, like Papa. And no manner of shouting will get our attention. I confess, I do not turn back.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.